across the heart of the Anatolian Plateau in central Turkey, at an altitude of 1,500 meters, there runs a deep valley that rips the land into jagged rock. This is the land called Cappadocia. Here, the erosion of the limestone plateau over the ages has produced a bizarre landscape, unlike any other in the world. A closer look reveals that the rocks are honeycombed with countless holes. These were once the dwellings of people. From the 4th to the 14th centuries, almost 2,000 temple caves were built here at Cappadocia. At its peak, tens of thousands of monks lived here, pursuing a life of strict devotion. All of the temple caves are decorated inside with murals. They also feature skillfully carved pillars and domes resembling those of conventional churches. The murals, which are based on the life of Christ, are in the tradition of Byzantine art, but the simplicity and strength of these works is considered unique to Cappadocia. In the earliest days, it was forbidden to portray human images, so artists used symbols of circles and crosses. Thus, within the desolate Rocky Mountains of Cappadocia, there once thrived a hidden Christian world. We leave Cappadocia behind and proceed due west. The lands from central Turkey westward are an endless expanse of rolling grassy plain. The road we are taking leads to the city of Bursa in western Turkey. Before Bursa lies a small town called Akçala. One after another, carts carrying mulberry leaves drive past us, for Akçala is one of the most famed silk-producing towns in Turkey. Silk is made in a number of towns in western Turkey, but we have heard that Akçala is known for the outstanding quality of its cocoons. It is about that time of the year when baby storks are born. This is when the truly busy season begins for the silk farmers. The women folk gather in the yard around a large neighborhood oven. Typically, a dozen or so households share the same oven. Each day, they light the oven at a set time. When the oven reaches the proper temperature, they rake out all the coals and then bake their bread with the remaining heat. They bake not just bread in these ovens, but all the various specialities of each household. Perhaps this custom of communal baking was born of the need to conserve labor during the busy silk-producing season. In any event, there is a warm neighborhood feeling to this daily chore. The silk farmers, meanwhile, are busy with the job of gathering the cocoons. The man who lives here, Ali Sura, is the third generation of silk farmers in his family.
Evet, bakımına dikkat ettik. Çok ateş yaktık. Sıra derecesiyle dereceyi dikkat ettik.
Bunların iyisini... Ali tells us proudly that his cocoons are the best quality in the village.
Seçiyoruz, biliyoruz yani.
Ölüyorlar. Biraz da geçen sene bir paket, iki paketten 10 kilo anca aldık. Aslında bir...
Ali tells us that he is taking these cocoons to the silk market, which begins the next day. The silkworms used in Akçala are a crossbreed between Chinese and Japanese silkworms. Silk is created out of the leaves of trees in the forest. That was how Vergilius, a Roman poet of the 1st century BC, described the making of silk. At that time, the manufacture of silk was a total mystery to the people of Rome, and indeed the entire West. China, the home of silk, kept the process of silk making in strict secrecy. How then did the secret of silk finally reach the West? One traditional explanation comes from the famed ancient traveler Xuanzang. Some 1800 years ago, there was a Buddhist kingdom called Khotan in the Taklamakan Desert, whose king took a wife from China. On instructions from the king, the queen and her attendant hid a supply of silkworm eggs and mulberry leaves inside her crown. They then smuggled these out of the country. Thus, for the first time, the secret of silkworm cultivation escaped China. There is another legend that explains how the secret of silk was carried yet further west. In the mid-6th century, two Christian monks journeyed from the distant east to Constantinople, capital of the Byzantine Empire. It is said that these monks carried with them a supply of silkworm eggs hidden in their walking sticks. When the monks were received by the Emperor Justinian, they removed the eggs from their sticks and presented them as a tribute to the ruler. Justinian was delighted and rewarded the monks generously. And so the secret of silk making reached the Roman world. The city of Bursa, surrounded by trees. Indeed, the people of Turkey call this city Bursa the Green. Bursa stands almost on the edge of the Asian continent. From here, it is less than 200 kilometers to the Bosphorus Straits, separating Asia from Europe. In the 14th century, this city flourished as the capital of the Ottoman Empire. Here rests the casket of the first Ottoman emperor, Sultan Uthman Khan, who reigned between 1299 and 1326. Covering the casket is a shroud of Bursa's distinctive silk, decorated with beautiful embroidery. The silk of Bursa has been famed ever since. Today, Bursa's population is 500,000. Owing to its gentle climate, this area has been a health resort ever since the days of the Ottoman Empire. Its streets of tile-roofed houses maintain much of their ancient tranquility. Bursa served as the Ottoman capital for less than 40 days. Thereafter, however, it remained an important post for trade with Persia and Arabia. In the center of Bursa stands a stately stone building called the Kozakhan. Built in the 15th century, it was originally a caravansary, or a resting place for passing caravans. Today, however, the Kozakhan serves a different role. The second floor, where traveling merchants once stayed, is now home to a row of silk wholesalers. The courtyard where horses and camels were once kept is today the site of an annual cocoon auction held every June. In English, Kozakhan means silk hall. We arrive just in time for this year's trading and see the baskets of cocoons being brought in. There are said to be some 20,000 households raising silkworms in the Bursa area. The cocoon market here in the Kozakhan courtyard lasts the entire month of June. During this month, more than 800 tons of raw silk are traded. The trading itself is a simple process. Farmers bring their cocoons to any of the 35 silk wholesalers in the Kozakhan. The price is established by one-to-one negotiations between the farmer and the wholesaler. In one corner of the courtyard, the buyers are busy exchanging information before the trading begins. Mr. Haki is 53 years old. He has been a shrewd silk buyer trading here for some 20 years. At 10 o'clock, a bell rings. The day's trading begins.
Baba yapsın yeter.
Bir lira alsın kuzum.
Vallahi almadım ben bir alsayı baba. Bir lira almadım yemin ederim. Yapmak onların şey değil mi? Bu kat.
Beş buçuk.
Bak bunu dört buçuk yapıyorum.
Beş buçuk.
Dört buçuk.
Beş buçuk.
Dur. Vallahi yazmam başkasına.
Dursun bak.
Yazmam bak babacığım. Yazmam.
Bak.
Şüphesini aldım onun için bunu yazıyorum.
Sen
yazmam başkasına.
Sen beş buçuk yazacaksın.
Bak, yok. Beş. Yok. Vallahi yazmam. Yok.
Beş buçuk. Bırak. Yaz dur. Öyle dursun. Öyle dursun. Dursun. Bırak. Dursun.
Bırak.
Dursun.
Bırak. Bırak. Bırak.
Bırak. Bırak. Bırak. Bırak. Bırak.
Yapma abi, 1700 lira.
Aldır. Kazanın altına.
Yaz abi, yaz. Yaz buraya için şey yapıyorum.
Again we see Mr. Ali, who we met yesterday in Elk Chala. He has brought with him almost 100 kilos of cocoons, the result of 2 months' hard work. For farmers like him, with their small cash incomes, the result of the silk market will influence the way they live all year. No negotiations are more important to them than these. Mr. Haki begins negotiations. The bargaining is hard and to the outsider may seem almost violent. This time, no deal.
Kaç para yazalım bana kardeşim?
Abi 1700 ödeyim ben.
Yok yok yok. 1650 lira bu kozak senin. Oldu mu? Kaça olacak bu son milyon? Kaça olacak kardeşim? Gideceğim elinde o beni.
Alamaz alamaz alamaz o.
Bu nerede? Seninki nerede? Bak şimdi.
Ya niye baktın kendine?
1675 dur burası ya. 1675 de olur mu bu? He?
Two young helpers follow Mr. Haki, shouting out assistance. And again, no deal.
Hakkını tamam.
Ne istiyorsun bunu amca?
1700.
1700 de kuzak var mı amca be? 1600 lira amca.
1650 lira verdin efendim.
Kimi?
Buna.
Vallahi verin ha.
Bak. Vallahi verdin. Bak sana yemin et. Mübarek günde yalan söylemeyin.
Ver tezkereye ver.
Yap. Kaç para yazdın buna kardeşim şimdi? Bırak şimdi.
1650.
Bir kuruş da sana yok. 1650 lira olmaz bu yenge. Vermişler ama başa işin. Başa işin gitmişler. Burada bir şey yok yenge. Bak başa işin bak. Bak. Allah aşkına yapmışlar bak. Bir şey yapmıyor yok yani. Aldı hiçbir şey yok yani.
Hep bakıyor.
Baba 1625 lira diyor.
1625
lira diyorum bak.
İpek yolu, ipek yolu.
1090
lira. Aman mal yapmış adam.
Yok canım.
Even the long experienced Mr. Haki is daunted by this woman.
Şimdi bana 1700 lira deme. 1700 lira hiç kural yazmasın.
1700 bunu demiyorum ben.
Bak, bunda bir şey yok yani. Bak şu bu malda hiçbir şey yok. Bak şu malda bak. Hiçbir şey yok.
Bak yaz bak hepsini de alıyorlar ha.
Hadi o. Bak bunlara. Bana veriyor musun 1625 liraya? Veriyor musun bana 1625 liraya? Bak ben nasıl alacağım bak.
Yaz yaz.
Yaz yaz. Yaz yaz.
This time a deal is made.
Kaldır abi. Kaldır abi.
Ne kaldırıyorsun?
Bak karşıya bak karşıya. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi.
Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak ipeyi. Bak
ipeyi. Köşeye bak.
Tamam tamam mı?
625 mi?
150 pas var. 1650 lira bu koza senin. Oldu mu?
Tamam hadi
kaça
tamam.
Olacak bu sen?
Ben neyim? Ben neyim? Ben
kaça olacak?
No doubt there were traders like Mr. Haki in the days of the Silk Road, waiting in oasis marketplaces to drive their bargains with passing caravans. The haggling of these hardened traders was probably as colorful and as explosive as fireworks.
Evet.
Once a price is settled, the cocoons are weighed and the deal is concluded. Mr. Ali Alçala managed to sell his cocoons for 1,400 lira per kilogram. He seems dissatisfied and admits that he wanted 50 lira more. Nevertheless, he took close into 140,000 lira. Now he says he will buy presents for his grandchildren and then return home. In Turkey, cocoons are called white gold, and indeed the silk market makes clear the value of this product.
Kontrol etmiyoruz zaten belli olur canım. Kuru kozak oldu mu şakır şakır yapar. Şakır şakır yani bak bu iyidir bu. Bu birinci kalite bu.
Böyle alttan üstten alıyorum
ben. He alttan üstten alıyorum. Bunu köylüye derdimizi aldığımız için böyle ağzını böyle aç öyle. Oruçluyuz biz şimdi. Niyetliyiz biz. Kitli bizim ağızdan. Fazla konuşamayız köylüye çünkü anladın mı? Bak.
Mr. Hackey told us, you can tell the quality of the cocoons by the sound they make when you put your hand in. Farmers have no skill in talking, so first you snub them, then you soothe them very kindly, and the deal is made. Mr. Hackey, hard driving silk broker that he might be, is a devout Muslim. After the morning's trading, he goes to the mosque to cleanse his body and pray. For his midday prayer, one of Islam's five daily prayers, Mr. Hackey always goes to a mosque near the Khoza Khan. First, he thanks Allah for the day's business. As the Quran teaches, it is no sin for thee to importune Allah for favor. Allah multiplies by many times the profits of those who work towards His will. In other words, as long as one deeply believes in Islam, he is allowed to profit by business. Hence the fervor of these prayers. After about half an hour of prayer, Mr. Hackey is ready to return to the rigors of his business. Mr. Hackey's home is in Bursa. Here, his wife spins into thread the silk Mr. Hackey has bought for his own personal use. The family has used this large pot ever since the days of Mr. Hackey's grandfather. Altogether in Bursa, some 200 households spin silk thread in this way. The fine threads of 30 cocoons are spun together to form a single strand of silk. This type of thread, which is slightly thicker than the ordinary, is used for silk carpets. The process of silk making, once a secret, carefully guarded within China, has thus traveled the length of the Silk Road to lay down roots even here in Borsa, at the far edge of Asia. From Borsa, we head to the Isparta region, near the Mediterranean Sea. Here on the gentle grassy plain, we come across an old stone-paved road. It is known as the Royal Road. Originally, this road was used by the army of the ancient Persian Empire. It was built in the 6th century BC by King Cyrus, after his forces had conquered this region. It has been called the world's first highway. As Persia's power grew in the following centuries, many other royal roads were built and came to be used for trade as well. Here too, the bells of each passing caravan must once have been heard. Near the Royal Road, we found a small village called Yelbach. Its 500 or so inhabitants are mostly farmers. As if out of respect for the age of this town, total silence reigns over its streets. In front of their house, a mother and daughter are weaving a rug. The custom in this region is that before marriage, every girl learns from her mother how to weave a carpet, which she then takes with her to her new home. We made a rather unusual discovery in this village. We noticed that the rocks used to build a wall here are engraved with letters and patterns. A closer look revealed that the script is unmistakably ancient Greek. Upon asking, we learned that these rocks were brought here from the ruins of a nearby Greek city named Antioch. Antioch thrived around the 3rd century BC. Thus, in this small village, the present peacefully coexists with the ancient past. Suddenly, the streets of the village came to life with cheerful music. We discovered that a wedding is about to take place. the men of the village danced in front of the bride's house. The village women have gathered in the courtyard. Not one man is to be seen in here. Indeed, this part of the ceremony is for women only. Men are forbidden to enter the house. The bride's name is Sukran. She is 18 years old. She is wearing a traditional Turkish wedding dress given to her by her husband-to-be. This is the bride's mother. Women's dance begins. Accompanying them is the music of the tep, an instrument resembling the tambourine. The bride now joins the dance. Wooden spoons provide the rhythm. The men still cannot enter. With a lonely look on his face, Mustafa, the bride's father, sits in the village square. It has been 7 hours since the dancing began. The sun is setting, and still they continue. A friend of the bride has appeared wearing a black moustache. We are told that she is to take the place of the groom, who is not allowed to enter here. Sukran dances happily. Finally, at 11 o'clock, the dancing ends. This part of the ceremony is a tearful farewell for the bride. The women sing sadly, "You were a good daughter, but now you leave us. Today we must part." The bride looks into a mirror to bid farewell to her unmarried self. Songs of farewell continue into the early hours of the morning. Thank you. next day, the bridal party arrives at the groom's house in a nearby village. Bride's face is hidden deep behind her veil. From the roof, the groom throws good luck gifts of money and sweets. Kadhi Oral, the groom, is 23 years old. Pinned to his clothes are gifts of money he has received for his wedding. The groom takes his bride by the hand and leads her into her new home. Together, they step over the blood taken from a sacrificial sheep. This signifies that they are now joined together as man and wife. Next, the household furnishings are brought in. This carpet took Sukran an entire year to weave. In the groom's yard, another dance begins. This time it is the dance of welcome by the women of the groom's village. Again, it will last well into the evening. We leave the village and continue towards the Bosphorus Straits. Our journey across the huge landmass of Asia is at last approaching its end. The Bosphorus Straits. Just 700 meters wide, this channel separates Asia and Europe. On the far side of the straits stands Istanbul. Over 1600 years and with three names, Byzantium, Constantinople and Istanbul, this city has been a great capital of the Western lands. And now, not far away, our final destination of Rome awaits us.